June 8th. It's time. Welcome to the channel.
Welcome.
Okay. Let's do it. June 8th is called Brick by Boring Brick.
Okay.
Yep.
I have some ideas, but let's read what's up.
Okay. Who do you think wrote the quote for today?
Brick by brick, probably.
Brick by boring brick.
Brick by boring brick, probably Seneca, I would say.
You're going to go with Seneca?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's probably the other guy.
It was our emperor. It was Marcus Aurelius.
Your reaction to what I said.
Gave it away.
Sorry. Is that what you think?
Oh, you think Seneca? That's cute. Duh, it's Marcus Aurelius.
I was just imagining like Marcus being in wars or something and not doing anything with bricks.
Oh, I could see Marcus because I feel like he's just like.
But even though he probably was,
he's so like focused on like the bad shit in life, so I could see him being like. Like, oh, I'm like, this life has to be boring. It's gets so boring. It's so good. It's so boring. But I don't know if you would ask me, like, if you made me guess, I don't know if I would have said Marcus. Okay. Here we go. It's like he gives us a paragraph, as per usual. You must build up your life action by action. And be content if each one achieves its goal as far as possible. And no one can keep you from this. But there will be some external obstacle. Perhaps, but no obstacle to acting with justice, self-control, and wisdom. But what if some other area of my action is thwarted? Well, gladly accept the obstacle for what it is and shift your attention to what is given, and another action will immediately take its place, one that better fits the life you are building. This one might be worth going into.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, we can do that. That's fine. Yeah. Yeah, it just reminded me of this, like, the theme of this whole month, right? Like, kind of, like, it's action by action. It's this long trajectory. It's gonna go very slow, many steps on the way. But the discipline needs to be there in order for that to continue. And, yes, it's gonna be hard and difficult, and there'll be obstacles, right?
Yeah, what I'm taking from this is, like, this quote for me is, like, going much deeper into how to deal with those obstacles.
Mm.
Because it's, like, so, like, there will be external obstacle, but even though there is an obstacle, I still have to act with justice, so I have to do the fair thing for everybody. I need to act with self-control. That's the discipline you're talking about. And wisdom. So, like, make sure I'm seeing this correctly. I'm not deluding myself as best I know how to do that. And then he's saying, but what if my action is thwarted? So, like, the obstacle, like, I put the action out there, and then life says, no. You're not going to get this. You're not going to get the thing you want. And you're like, well, I did the action so I could get the thing that I want. And life's like, no. Then he's saying, gladly accept the obstacle for what it is. So, okay, I accept this. And then shift your attention to what is given. So, like, shift my attention now to this new reality of, like, life is this new thing. And when I do that, another action will immediately take its place, one that better fits the life you are building. So, like, because sometimes there's that, I do have that question of, like, I do something, life says no, and like then I'm like, okay, well, like now how do I behave? Like now what do I do?
I get mad.
Right. And so he's saying, accept it, look at the given of this new reality, and suddenly I will be smart, I will know how to act, and the act will be a smarter action than if I let myself get mad or I let myself get like bent out of shape about something.
I don't have anything else.
No.
No, that's a good one. I mean, yeah, like...
brick by boring brick.
Yeah.
Because he's also saying, like, be content if each action achieves its goal as far as possible. And I have been confused on that because it's like, well, I'm doing something for a reason because I want the result, like, and I want to want things. Remember, like, a couple of months ago, I was in this, like, weird place here where it was like, but I don't think wanting is bad. Mm-hmm. Like, so here, it's like, no, wanting is fine. Wanting is good. I need wanting to direct my life. But then, like, be satisfied with whatever actually comes of the goal. Like, however much of the goal was achieved or not achieved, like, I need to be okay with that.
But isn't he saying to, like, squeeze it to the last drop in some way? Like when you choose that new option, like, follow it to its completion. Or as far as it can go.
I think so. Am I saying something contrary to that?
No. I'm just trying to understand if that's what he's saying. Like, he's saying, when you choose something, to follow it to its completion.
Choose something like what? Like, choose like a goal or choose an action to do?
Yeah. Goal is like many actions to that, or one action. So either one, but you want some results or something. And so he's saying, keep trying it until you get those results.
I don't know if I'm hearing that in this specific
way. Or until you exhaust the options of what you can do.
I think he's saying, like, you will keep going towards it because of going through it in the way where it's like, I act, there's an obstacle, I accept the obstacle, I look at the reality of this obstacle, and I keep acting. So I don't, like, yeah, I don't, like, give up or something or throw in the towel.
Or don't give up, like, too. Well, and that's where it kind of sits strangely, because it kind of, like, how do we know when you are beating a dead horse versus you are giving up too prematurely? Yeah. But maybe there is some sort of a signal there. Like, we want to know this maybe ahead of time. I want to know when enough is enough, right? Ahead of time. But maybe that's unknowable ahead of time. Maybe we just, that's the trust in itself that we will know when enough is enough. And then I will say then, okay, this definitely feels like this needs to pivot to something different, right? And now you're pivoting and changing. But until then, we can't almost like manufacture that because we haven't exhausted. That's the exhaustion. The exhaustion of it, like, oh, that's when it comes, like, okay, let's pivot. Like, the exhaustion starts the next action.
It motivates you sufficiently to change because you're like, I know I can't keep going the way that I have been because I got here.
Yeah.
So what am I going to do? I'm just going to keep doing this and get here again in another couple of months. That doesn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. So either I need to quit whatever this
and
thing
AKA,
is.
And AKA, what is it? Like the same mistakes, maybe? Maybe you can look at it that way, too. Like when you...
You keep
when
making
you,
the same mistakes over and over
When you make
again.
The same mistakes, that's a good indication that pivoting is necessary or something, you know?
And then you get better about noticing the mistakes as they're happening, the more mistakes that you make, actually.
Yeah.
So it's like, the solution is not to try to stop making mistakes or lead a life where you're making less. Mm-hmm. Actually, you need to start leading a life where you're making more mistakes.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I need to develop myself into someone who is anti-fragile.
Yeah,
I can handle that.
Yeah, because that's, I was saying that the other day about like the relationship we have with mistakes and how like we look at mistakes as like this bad thing or something, you know, versus it's like a more of a, it should be really looked upon more of as like a learning thing.
Yeah,
very cool.
Okay, you ready for Ryan?
Mm-hmm.
He says, elite athletes in collegiate and professional sports increasingly follow a philosophy known as the process. It's a philosophy created by University of Alabama coach Nick Saban, who taught his players to ignore the big picture. Important games, winning championships, the opponent's enormous lead, and focus instead on doing the absolutely smallest things well. Practicing with full effort, finishing a specific play, converting on a single possession. A season lasts months, a game lasts hours, catching up might be four touchdowns away, but a single play is only a few seconds, and games and seasons are constituted by seconds. If teams follow the process, they tend to win. They overcome obstacles and eventually make their way to the top without ever having focused on the obstacles directly. If you follow the process in your life, assembling the right actions in the right order, one right after another, you too will do well. Not only that, you will be better equipped to make quick work of the obstacles along that path. You'll be too busy putting one foot in front of the next to even notice the obstacles were there.
Speaks to you from there?
Yeah. He's talking about like the perception of time. You know, like it's so easy to, let's say like I'm a college athlete, it would be so easy for me to focus on this bigger time frame where I'm winning games or championships. Or now it's multiple seasons and I'm in the Hall of Fame or something like that. Like the mind tends to like blow out these time frames and get obsessed about these much larger time frames. And when it does that, I'm building up an intolerance for the small time frames, the impatience that also you and I have been talking about for the last few days. And it's so interesting, like, because then there's also in spirituality this idea of like the present moment and like living in the present moment. And, like, what does that actually mean? And I think it's like this process thing of like being in a much smaller time frame where I'm typing this sentence right now to type this sentence and be with this sentence and think about what I'm trying to communicate with this sentence and who's going to read this sentence and like that, like being there rather than where I could also be, which is, oh, I wonder how many people are going to open this email. Or I wonder if this email is going to make me any sales. Or something like that's like a much bigger time frame that like pulls me out of just being with the process, like the individual moments. And I've noticed that when I'm in the individual moments, like I can find something really enjoyable in those individual moments. In a way where when I'm obsessing over this larger time frame, it feels kind of out of control because I'm like...
I mean, obsessing, no, but still, yeah, I would say thinking about that and planning that bigger picture is important. But then when you go to actioning for that plan, now it cannot, you cannot be thinking about that plan.
Yeah.
And so then there's probably like a place of like reminding ourselves to like check on the plan periodically, but don't like not obsessing about it, right? But periodically, let's say like, hey, let's say once a week, at the end of the week, like, hey, have I done everything throughout this week that was aligned with that thing that I'm trying to reach? Checking that against it, right? Because then I can also see like, well, extreme, what he was describing about the basketball, right? Like, so if you're like an extreme, if you take it in some sort of extreme way, then like, well, if I'm just passing a ball, and I'm not understanding that like we need to like move forward or something, like I'm going to be doing this monkey job, which is this one little thing in the second, but then I'll never try to shoot at the basket or something because I'm like obsessed about this one thing that I need to perfect down to the you know what I mean. So it's like it could be, there has to be some sort of a, like maybe it's 50 actions that you're doing and you're concentrating on making the right one right now. Right now I have to pass the ball. Right now I have to shoot the ball. Right now I have to, so you constantly, you're not thinking about, oh, we're gonna win, right? Or we're gonna, or hey, what should I have for dinner, right? Like you're only choosing from these handful of actions that are possible and you're saying, yes, focus on the smallest possible thing. So yeah, I like that. But then after the game, you now have to go back to the plan and check, hey, were we doing that the right way?
Yeah, I guess I'm sort of taking for granted that the plan is already in place. Mm-hmm. Because of course, there needs to be some directionality to the tactics. They need to add up to something. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I want to be clear on what my goal is and what my plan is. And when I sit down to like write an email, let's say, I have that in mind. And so the harder thing for me is to actually give that up and just be like, all right, now let me just actually be in my writing. And it's easier for me to be half in my writing and half also like thinking about that bigger picture, mm-hmm. and freaking out in some degree to, mm-hmm. that bigger picture and not paying enough attention actually to the brick by boring brick, yeah, part of the whole thing.
The word by word or something, in your case.
Yeah.
Or note by note in my case.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Or even like, you know, the word by, because like I enjoy writing and you enjoy playing music, but then like let me look at some other part of the business that I don't like that much. That's even harder to do because it's not like something that's naturally interesting to me.
Right. Yeah, I'm so terrible at that. Like marketing and me, like, oh my God. What? I just want to play guitar, dude. And so I do. And I have nothing from it. except awesome times.
All right, thanks for joining today. See you tomorrow.